direct from Southern California, the car capital of the world, the Auto Channel presents exclusive press pass coverage of the Los Angeles Auto Show.
Stefan Jacoby joined Volvo this past summer after a stellar career at Volkswagen and Mitsubishi. He comes to Volvo expecting to be instrumental in its rejuvenation and new ownership. His can-do attitude should blend very well with the can-do attitude that powered China to recently become the largest automotive market in the world. We are all anxious to see what sort of offspring this amazing venture will produce. And here to give us an early glimpse is our 2010 Motor Press Guild keynote address speaker, the president and CEO of Volvo Car Corporation, Mr. Stefan Jacoby.
Thank you, James. Thank you, James, for this very nice introduction. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the Motor Press Guild. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak here to you today. As you know, I spent 3 years in the United States with VW before I moved to Sweden a couple of months ago. This is actually my first motor show on American ground since I joined Volvo Car Corporation in August. One of my first objectives as CEO had been, first of all, to dive in and gain these 100 days of really having the freedom to learn everything about Volvo, the challenges and the business. And I said also to my spokesman, I want to avoid the press as much as possible. I will tell you, I failed with both of these objectives at the very beginning. Anyway, I'm glad to be here in Los Angeles. California is the place where many automotive trends are born, and the Los Angeles Motor Show is an important indicator of the direction the US market is heading for. Los Angeles is also where Volvo's dream of conquering America's road started 55 years ago. The first batch of the cute round PV444 arrived here in August 1955. A small Swedish upstart in the land of the Cadillac and the Lincoln. The skeptics compared the Volvo adventure to selling refrigerators to Eskimos. But the red PV444HS, keep this in mind, with white wall tires made a very promising appearance at the classic California State Fair a month later. I'd like to assume that the letters HS stood for hot stuff. In order to compete with the US muscle cars, the PV had the same 70 horsepower engine as the Swedish police cars at that time. We sold a modest of 26 cars in the United States in 1955. But they paved the way for many more to come, and the numbers grew rapidly. In 1956, Volvo was the second largest import brand in California. In 1957, we passed the 10,000 car mark, and by the beginning of the 80s, Volvo was the largest European car exporter to the United States. These early PVs had the same Swedish heart and soul as all Volvos before and after them. Our founders, Assa Gabrielsen and Gustav Larsen, pointed out the direction already in 1927. They started point was, cars are driven by people. Cars are driven by people. You might think that it sounds pretty obvious, but hold that thought for a second. In the hands of skilled Swedish engineers, this philosophy has resulted in a number of fantastic inventions. In 1959, Niels Bohlin invented the three-point safety belt. No feature in the automotive history has saved more lives. Today, it is a part of all cars everywhere. So there is a little part of Volvo in your car as well, even if you don't drive a Volvo. In 1976, Stefan Wallmann introduced the three-way catalytic converter with the electronic lambda sensor to the US authorities. The test revealed that the technology removed more than 90% of the harmful emissions from the engine. It was so efficient that the federal EPA lab wanted to run the test once more. There must have been something wrong with the equipment of testing the car. The second test confirmed the first, and the Volvo 240 came to the United States with the catalytic converter just a year later. The first 10 cars were brought by the state of California. They drove one of them all the way to Washington in order to show the US officials that Volvo has made the impossible possible. Tom Quinn, at that time chairman of California Air Resources Board, said, "This is the most important breakthrough ever for reducing exhaust emissions from cars." Today, all cars with combustion engine have a catalyst converter. So you will be glad to know that there is another little part of Volvo in your car as well. I could go on with all of these examples, such as the side impact protection system and our whiplash injury protection system, WHIPS. The all-new S60 sports sedan, revealed in Detroit in 2009, comes with our latest breakthrough safety innovation. Volvo's today's engineer, Jonas Tiesel, has led the work on the pedestrian detection with full auto brake. It helps Volvo drivers avoiding collisions with pedestrians. Ladies and gentlemen, I have deliberately named the Volvo people behind these great innovations, just to prove my point that cars for people must be developed by people who really care. It's as simple as that. And the unique spirit of our people is what makes Volvo, Volvo. We like people. We study them, we listen to them, and then we go home and we do our homework. We believe that the ultimate luxury is to own a car that fits you, understands you, and evolves together with you. Ultimately, you jump in behind the wheel for the first time, you take a look at the dashboard, and you find everything so functional, so obvious, that you're ready to take off directly. Wouldn't it be great, for example, to just ditch the owner's manual? Actually, we are working on this right now. While we are at it, let's ditch the talk about premium as well. In the ears of the customers, the word has an expensive ring to it. Sounds like a pricing strategy. I'd rather like to talk about the special kind of luxury, Scandinavian luxury. I'm talking of that elegant Scandinavian simplicity. In Sweden, we don't design a car and then put the driver in it. Instead, we put the person in the middle first. Then we design the car around the driver's needs, around the driver's behavior, pleasure, and well-being. Our design director, Paul Horbury, always says, the form follows the function. If a design isn't functional, it can't be beautiful either. I'm the first to admit that a car must be an object of desire to attract the most demanding customers. But pure desire turns into something different when you want to drive this desirable object in 55 miles per hour down a busy four-lane freeway with two kids in the rear seat demanding to be in Disneyland in less than 5 minutes. Then a car with only the right curb appeals falls short. What you need are brains. A car that understands what you need. A car that helps you staying in command. You want a comfortable cockpit, a superb ergonomics that makes you feel relaxed and yet focused. This driver-centric approach is what modern and future Volvos are all about. We will stand out of the crowd by delivering a distinguished car experience and not by copying our main competitors. Instead, we will do it by carving out our own unique Scandinavian profile. Our present focus on cutting CO2 emissions is a good example. More and more people are asking for fuel efficiency. alternative fuel, and innovative electric vehicles in their search for a sustainable mobility. But all these conscious people don't want to compromise with the pure joy of owning a luxury car. Why should they? Looking at the trends during the recent Paris Motor Show, it is no doubt that our industry is putting a lot of research and efforts into electrifications. That's why we are working on various initiatives. All of them offer the same full experience as a car with a traditional driveline. When we displayed the C30 Drive E Electric at the Paris Motor Show, it actually pulled more attention than our new S60 and V60. This car is powered solely by electricity, entirely without exhaust emission. It has a range of up to 150 kilometers. We will introduce this car as a test fleet in California next week. It is actually on display here and will be part of the Green Car Journal Drive event tomorrow, so be sure to check it out. The lithium ion batteries made here in the United States, are uniquely packed in the center of the vehicle. They are completely removed from any crash zones in the front and in the rear. Our work on electrification technologies includes a systematic approach to safety issues. A battery-powered Volvo must be as safe as any Volvo car. And I tell you, we have tested the C30 Drive Electric several times, and full-scale crash tests representing 5 stars in Euro and NCAP clearly prove that we are doing the right things. For those who need more range, we will introduce a plug-in hybrid in 2012. It will have emissions of less than 50 grams of CO2 per kilometer. We will start selling it in Europe with a diesel engine backing up by the electrical motor. Later, the plug-in hybrid will come to the United States with a gasoline engine from our next engine generation. We will also use power hybrids to give other models more mileage to gallon. And we are working on a new downsized generation of gasoline and clean diesel engines. They will span across a wide range of reduced weight as well as CO2. Our rapid pace in environmental care and electrification underlines that you are reading a new chapter in Volvo's history book. On the 2nd of August this year, we became an independent company with Geely as our shareholder. From now on, you can expect us to be leaner, better, smarter, and especially faster. It is actually not that the big ones are eating the small ones. It's that the fast ones are eating the slow ones. If we play our cards right, I can imagine selling 800,000 cars per year in 2020. Our strategy is based on our products, on our technology, and on markets to define for our future. In the next 6 months, we will put together the growth strategy that will take us there. Our three core markets are Europe, where our objective is to increase our market share to 2%, China, and the United States. But we also see growth potentials, for example, in markets like Brazil. Ladies and gentlemen, let me start with China. Volvo has been present in China since 1984. We currently have limited local production in China. So far this year, our sales in China are up almost 50% versus 2009. Our Chinese shareholders open up possibilities for a significant expansion. We have recently established a new organization for our China operations, where we are doubling and mirroring the functions we have at the head office in Gothenburg. We will soon announce our growth plan for China. I would say we are announcing this within the next couple of weeks. Stay tuned. In the recent issue of The Economist, there's an interesting article about Chinese takeovers. The headline was, "Being Eaten by the Dragon." And on the subjects of takeover, I know that concerns have been raised about Volvo and Geely becoming mixed as brand. I share the view of Mr. Li Shifu of the holding company. We both understand that it is essential that Volvo continue to be Volvo. And I'd like to state that Volvo will be even more Volvo than ever before. Ladies and gentlemen, I have to be a little bit humble and admit that after our peak year with almost 140,000 cars here in the United States in 2004, we have lost ground here in this very important market. This is mainly due to the financial crisis and also a negative currency development. Now you could say that we are standing at the bottom and looking up. This is somehow positive, and that's our position right now. It means that things can only get better from now on. And I can assure you that we will be working hard to please the American luxury market buyers in the coming years. We will bring more attractive products. We will improve our customer care, once again putting people in the center of everything we do. And we will strengthen our market and dealer activities in this very important market here in the United States. The latest consumer report actually brought us very positive news. Four of our models achieved a recommended rating. The C70 convertible had the best performance in its segment. The XC60 was second best, and the C30 came in third in its segment. On top of this, the Volvo S60 is an ongoing success. The recent launch of the S60 will be an essential part of the growth plan here in the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, Volvo has enjoyed a 55 years love affair with the United States. We have had a somewhat bumpy ride recently, but at Volvo, we are incurable optimists. We still believe in the promise of mobility, and we are convinced that our heritage, putting people first, gives us a unique opportunity. 2010 is an important year for the entire automotive industry, and of course also with the ownership change of Volvo Cars Corporations. Core markets in Europe and in the United States are slowly recovering after the global crisis, thank God. But we are also noticing that the market is very volatile, making it very difficult to predict the future. We believe in the US market, and we are dedicated to help American motorists keep on enjoying the freedom of open roads for generations to come. We will do this by approaching the future with a very open mind and with our original entrepreneurial spirit in excellent shape. Volvo will be one global brand and with one global product lineup. But of course, we will, and we are differentiating our products by looking for specific adaptations market by market. Consumer demands are globally different. One classic example in the United States, but especially also in China, is that consumers are asking for bigger cars as in Europe. And if you want to be successful in these markets, you need to listen to the customers. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your attention. I hope you will have a great show, and I hope you will have a chance to step by at the Volvo stand. Thank you very much, and I'm looking forward to answer your questions. Thank you.
If you have any questions, there's a microphone in the middle aisle there. You're welcome to line up. In the meantime, we'll get started right here, I guess. Can you turn this on, please? Okay, thanks.
Bill McCallum, the editor of Global Auto News. The Chinese government has maintained a consistent policy on owning in controlling intellectual property of automaker partners in China. Do you anticipate any problem with this policy when and if China starts exporting cars around the world?
I cannot answer for the entire industry. I only can answer for what kind of agreements had been made with our previous owner, Ford. The intellectual property rights are clearly defined, and I see no reasons to be concerned in that area in respect of Volvo and Geely.
Thank you.
Next question to your right over here, Stefan.
Zoran Segina from LA Car. This is a question on behalf of my colleague at work who is looking to buy a new car. Since I have two Volvos that are driven to about 250,000 miles each, I wanted to suggest a Volvo, to which he replied, but how about the quality? They're now owned by the Chinese. How do you, as a CEO of Volvo, overcome the image that your new partner may have, may not have as stellar image as the old Volvos of yours that I used to drive?
Well, we are very aware where Volvo stands for. Volvo stands for Scandinavian design. Volvo stands for solid quality, reliability, and of course, Volvo stands also for safety. And we would be stupid if we would gave up these values. I think we will maintain these values. We will add a couple of other brand values to make the brand more desirable in respect of what we understand with Scandinavian luxury, and I mentioned in my speech here. But we will not give up our quality standards, our safety standards, and our automotive technology, which we are using in our cars.
Okay, next question, Alicia.
Hi, Alicia Webb. I'm representing Automotive News China today. Mr. Jacoby, what Volvo models do you think are most appropriate for the China market?
Do you have time for another 2 hours here?
Sure.
Well, that's exactly why we are working on right now. I think that we have to look into the classical sedan segments, which are actually have a predominant segment share in the United States, but also in China. We are looking for cars which are in a bigger size than we have the offer right now. We'll adapt this with extension of the vehicles for the Chinese market as well. I cannot make right now any statements about our product strategy in China. Please stay tuned for a couple of weeks. We'll make the announcement before the end of the year.
Oh, can I just clarify, you said extension of vehicles. Do you mean like the S80 long version, that you're going to make more long versions?
You know, competitors are doing this as well. So there's no reason that we're also not looking in these kind of opportunities. Chinese consumers demand bigger cars. It's a chauffeurs-driven market. Chinese have other demands in the cars, like, for example, European customers. And if you want to be successful in China, we have to listen to the customers in China and have adapt our cars as well. That does not mean that this will be not an original Volvo.
Okay, next question over here to the right, sir.
Morning, Stefan.
Good morning.
Mark Phelan with the Detroit Free Press. The currency question has been an ongoing challenge for Volvo in the United States. It was the first one that you mentioned among the challenges. How does Volvo get out of that box? Do you move production to somewhere other than Europe for vehicles destined for the United States?
Yeah, this is a very good question. This question I have about approximately when I wake up at 3 o'clock, having the jet lag coming here to the United States. And the United States as a European manufacturer is, as you all know, a very difficult and challenging business because mainly of the currency. And I think there's not one golden key to open suddenly and you say we are manufacturing here in the United States and then everything is fine. I think it takes a lot more thoughts in how to conquer and how to have a proper position and share here in this market than just saying we will have a local manufacturing. But right now, we prioritized our thoughts of extending our overseas productions to China, but that does not mean that we are not working on a US strategy The U.S. is another focus market of Volvo, and we are working on alternatives in this market as well.
Next question from the center.
Steve Usher from JI Asia. A bit of a follow-up on the previous question. Could you comment on your production plans for China, and if possible, give us some specifics?
No, I cannot comment. I said, please be patient for a couple of weeks. We are making our announcement before the end of this year.
Thank you.
And from the center, please.
Wen Xing from China Auto Review. Jacoby, I hope you remember me.
I do.
Thank you. By the way, you're invited for our 2011 Global Auto Symposium in Shanghai.
Thank you.
Personally, I got two questions. One is, Ms. Li Shufu, I'm going to try to get you because of your background working for Volkswagen in China. Volkswagen has been, is still the most successful foreign automaker in China. So what did it make you to decide to come to Volvo and to be a family with Geely to work in China again? That's number one question. Second question is, the Chinese media just recently reported that there's a, Mr. Li Shufu said he has some different views with some board members with regard to where Volvo is moving in China. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, I can do this. I think it is understandable that with the new ownership, with a very skilled and experienced board, and with our management team, we are in deep discussions about our future product line. I mean, every manufacturer is doing this. The products which we are defining now, the technology which we are defining now, the platform and module strategy which we are defining now is the future success of Volvo globally. And it is obvious that we are discussing pros and cons of various alternatives and that we have a very fruitful discussions. And I have to tell you, I'm also not agreeing everything which I have seen in the first weeks and months. And we are in especially in this transformation process where we are defining our strategy in respect of the products and the lineups for the future. There's nothing to be worried about. It's a normal process, and I appreciate, actually, that we have that fruitful discussion with that very skilled board members at Volvo. It will be for the good for Volvo. Why did I change my job? I really like challenges in the automotive industry. And first of all, Volvo is a fascinating brand. And I believe that with a volume at around 400,000 vehicles a year, we have really not explored the potential of Volvo. Volvo is a very strong brand. Wherever I meet dealers, they're very motivated. They want to change and they want to grow. And I'm the right man for this growth. And I like also, with my global experience over my 25 years of automotive experience, I like to work for a new setup. Yes, we are owned by a Chinese private entrepreneur. This is maybe the very first investment a Chinese entrepreneur is doing outside of China. And I think we need to get used to this. China is an integrational part of the global economy. We produce in China, we export from China, so we have to actually also respect that Chinese investors are investing their money in overseas enterprises. And working in Sweden, as being originally a German, together with a Chinese entrepreneur, independent company, is a challenge which I think is very unique in the automotive industry. And I like to take over this challenge. It's an honor for me to have been selected to be the CEO, and I like the work which is ahead of me.
Thanks for watching The Auto Channel. For more great coverage of all major motor events, visit theautochannel.com, the internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive resource.